Mark Arnold. Get up here.
Get up here.
Get on his guitar. Get on his guitar.
Page 345, where can I go, D? Starting at verse 14, we'll start there. It says, and they lifted up their voice and wept again. And Orpah kissed her mother-in-law, but Ruth clave unto her. So Ruth and her husband Elimelech, they traveled to Moab because there was the famine in the land. And they went, and while they were there, Elimelech died. Ruth still had her two sons, Chilion and Mahlon. And they went and they found them wives in Moab and married two women, one being Orpah and the other being Ruth. And so after a while, her two sons died. And at that point in time, there's no children. Her two sons and their wives had not had children at that time. And so it was just her and her two daughters-in-law. And she had heard while she was in Moab that God had blessed the children of Israel and had given them food. So she just decided to return back to her homeland, to go back there because they were starving there too. I mean, she didn't have a husband or sons to take care of her. It was just her and the two daughter-in-laws. So she returned, and while she was started to leave, she told Orpah and Ruth, said, you two, you know, go back to your parents' house. Go back to your mothers and fathers. You know, I have no more to give you. There is nothing else for me to give you at this time. You know, go back to who you know and be good. You know, if you go back and find your husband, you know, take care of your parents. Do what you need to do. You don't have to come with me. And they had cried about it, and she said, you know, if I don't have any more children for you to wed, there's no more children for you to wed. I have no more sons. And even if I did get another husband, it would be this many years before that son would be ready. And if I had a son, it'd be this many years before that son would be ready to wed you and give you children. Are you going to wait all those years? You know, go ahead and go back and find you a husband. You've dealt kindly with me, kindly with my children. You know, you've been good to us. You were good wives. Go ahead and go. I release you of your duty. That's basically what she was telling them. And in verse 14, it says, you know, they cried again, of course, because this is a lady that they have been living with for many years. This is their mother-in-law, and family was very important in that day. And they cried because they knew they, even if they did leave her, that was a piece of their life they were leaving behind. And so they were saddened by that. And the two women each made a choice. And they made a choice. Orpah decided, I'm going to go ahead and take advantage of the release that she's given me, and I'm going to go back to my family. And she left and returned to her family. But Ruth decided, I can't do this. You know, once I became, basically, this is my thought of what she was thinking. Once I became a part of that family, I am a part of that family. Through thick or thin, good or bad, this is where I'm staying. And so she told Ruth, said, I can't. And she just hung on to her and said, no, I cannot leave you at this time. I'm here with you always. And she just hung on to her. And she said, behold, thy sister-in-law has gone back unto her people and unto her gods. Return now after thy sister-in-law. And Ruth said, entreat me not to leave thee. I can't leave thee. Don't tell me to go. You are now my mother. You are now my family. Don't tell me to leave you. For whither thou goest, I will go, and where thou lodgest, I will lodge. Thy people shall be my people, and thy God, my God. I am part of you, and no matter what, wherever you go, I'll go with you. And whoever you serve, I will serve. I will give up everything. When I moved away from my parents, when I left my family and married your son, I broke away from them. I became part of your family. And she said, no matter what, I'm not leaving you. I will do what you do and what you have me to do. Where thou diest, will I die, and there will I be buried. The Lord do so to me, and more also, if aught but death part thee and me. And she said that, you know, if I leave now or leave in the future, then God can deal harshly with me. because I'm making you this vow right now, I'm not leaving. I am not going to leave you. And if I do, let God deal harshly with me. If it's only death can part us at this point in time. And it says in verse 18, when she saw that she was steadfastly minded to go with her, then she left speaking unto her. So Naomi at that point realized that there was no talking her out of this. Nothing whatsoever was going to talk Ruth out of going with her. No matter how much she commanded her, how much she admonished her, you know, it did not matter. Ruth had made up her mind. And I thought about this a while last night and this morning while I was studying this. This is a representation of us. This is a representation of our commitment to God. Right? So we come as children to Christ. We come humbly unto Him. We ask God to come into our life, to remove the sin out, to make us a new creature. And when we do that, we take and we break every tie that bound us to our former life. And see, what Ruth did here was when she married into this family, she essentially broke ties with her former life. That's what she did. She said, this is where I am now. This is the life I'm going to lead. I have family back here, and I'm sure she didn't forget any of them. I'm sure that they were always on her mind and in her heart. And she, while she was in the country of Moab, she communicated with that family and interacted with that family. But she broke away from that family. And that's what God expects of us.
Right.
We are to go and come unto Him, repent, receive the Holy Ghost, and become children of Him. And we are to break away from that prior life that we had. And as Ruth went on through her life, she married into the family, then something happened. Something terrible happened. Her husband died. There was no more. There was no more life for her immediate family. She could not give life. She could not produce life because there was none now. She had this terrible thing happen in her life. And at the time that Naomi decided to go back home because she had heard there was good at home, and Naomi told her to go return to your prior family, Ruth hung on to her. We have times in our life when something bad hits us. We hit a wall. And we have to make that choice. Do we return back to our prior life? Or do we hold on to God with all we have? Are we like Ruth? And we say, no matter what happens, where you go, where you take me, I'm going with you. Or are we like Orpah, who said, okay, I want to go, but finally said, no, I think I'll go back. I don't know if I want to go over there because that's unknown to me. I'm going to stay with what I know. And what I know was my old life. And we have to be very careful because there's that fine line there.
That's right.
You can have interactions with your life, with that former life. You can have interaction with the people in your former life. But when times get hard and times get rough, you have to be Ruth. You have to become as Ruth. You have to hang on to what you have been given, the newness in your life, because there's a reason and a purpose for it. God is never going to take you and forsake you.
Amen.
That promise is in the Bible. You hold on to Him, He will take you through.
Amen.
That doesn't mean you're not going to have rough times. And that doesn't mean you're not going to hit a wall every now and then. But God will get you past it. He will take you past it, and you will come out ahead.
Amen.
As we go on through Ruth, and you'll see. But that was the start of the thought that God put in my heart. Was this is a representation of our Christian life. Yeah, I got water. Thank you. Just dirt, digging dirt yesterday has just messed up my throat. So if I clear my throat every once in a while. It's okay. But it is a representation of our Christian walk. And we have to take this first bit of Ruth and apply that to our life. If you're a new Christian, especially, if you have just recently turned your life over to God or recently came back to God, either one, you need to take it and say, no matter what God throws my way, I'm going to hang on to Him, just like Ruth hung on to Naomi. And she followed her back to home. She knew she had this former life. She knew she had this family. But you know what? She knew where she should be and where she needed to go. You need to be like Ruth and not like Orpah in the situation. And it says in verse 19, so the two went until they came to Bethlehem. And it came to pass when they were come to Bethlehem that all the city was moved about them. And they said, is this Naomi? And she said unto them, call me not Naomi, call me Mara. For the Almighty hath dealt very bitterly with me. I went out full, and the Lord hath brought me home again empty. Why then call ye me Naomi, seeing the Lord hath testified against me, and the Almighty hath afflicted me? So Naomi returned, and Ruth the Moabitess, her daughter-in-law, with her, which returned out of the country of Moab, and they came to Bethlehem in the beginning of the barley harvest. And the barley harvest is very important here. Very, very, very important in Ruth's story, in the life of Ruth, because she came in at the time that barley, the harvest had started. And I'm probably going to read a lot of scripture, but Ruth is only 4 chapters long, so I would encourage you to go back and read this again on your own.
Yes.
Because it is a very, very good history of what we need to do. And it says in chapter 2, and Naomi had a kinsman of her husband's, a mighty man of wealth, of the family of Elimelech, and his name was Boaz. And Ruth the Moabitess said unto Naomi, let me now go to the field and glean ears of corn after him, in whose sight I shall find grace. And she said unto her, go, my daughter. So Ruth came unto Naomi and said, you know, I can imagine part of the conversation was, we don't have anything here. We have nothing. We've come back home. People know you. You have family here. But we have nothing. We don't have a man in our house who can take care of us. It's just me and you. I need to go out and glean the fields. Let me go. Let me go out and glean the fields. And Naomi said, go. And if you don't understand what gleaning the fields is, I looked that up in Deuteronomy. And in Deuteronomy 24, verse 19 is where it starts. It says, when thou cuttest down thine harvest in thy field, and hast forgot a sheep in the field, thou shalt not go again to fetch it. It shall be for the stranger, for the fatherless, and for the widow, that the Lord thy God may bless thee in all the work of thy hands. When thou beatest thine olive tree, thou shalt not go over the boughs again. It shall be for the stranger, for the fatherless, for the widow. When thou gatherest the grapes of thy vineyard, thou shalt not glean it afterwards. It shall be for the stranger, for the fatherless, and for the widow. And thou shalt remember that thou wast a bondsman in the land of Egypt. Therefore I command thee to do this thing. So gleaning the fields was meant to be for the fatherless, for the stranger in the land, for the widow. Now, you've got to think about Ruth and Naomi at this point in their life. They're fatherless. Ruth's a stranger. They're both widows. They have no one. So God had commanded back in Levitical law for when you harvest your field, you don't go back and pick up what you dropped. That's basically what it is. You don't go back and pick up what you dropped. If you dropped it on the ground, you leave it. And those who have nothing and have no one to care for them can come back through and pick that up and sustain themselves. That's what it's all about. That you've left there to take care of those who have no one else to take care of them. And so she asked Naomi, said, please, let me go glean the fields. And Naomi said, go ahead, go glean the fields. We're at the barley harvest. Go see what you can get, and we'll see what we can do to take care of ourselves. Verse 3, it says, and she went and came and gleaned in the field after the reapers. And her hap was to light on a part of the field belonging unto Boaz, who was of the kindred of Elimelech. She happened into a field that was owned by a kinsman. Now I got to thinking about that too. Was that by chance? People in this world would say, oh, that was, you know, coincidence. That was coincidence. That was by chance. She just happened across a field that was owned by some of her family, you know, her mother-in-law's family. Sure, what, you know, okay, it is what it is. Yeah, small world. It's a small world. No, it wasn't by chance. It wasn't by coincidence. It was by God's favor. That's how this happened. Ruth had taken and decided, made a conscious decision to go with Naomi and to serve her God. Her people would be, Naomi's people would be Ruth's people. Naomi's God would be her God. She put away all the pagan gods she was serving. And she vowed to serve the one true God. When she did that, when she went with Naomi, she made that vow. She found God's favor. She found favor of God. And after that point in time, as Sister Georgiana said, her footsteps were ordered of God. And it wasn't by chance, it wasn't by coincidence that she went to the very field to glean that was Boaz's. God directed her there. Absolutely. Unknowingly to her, but God directed her to that field. God directs us every day. Once we take that step and we make that commitment and that vow to God to serve Him, and we cling to Him and hold on to Him throughout, no matter what happens, God will order our footsteps. And He will put us in a place of favor. He will move us into that place of favor, just as He did Ruth. He put her in Boaz's field. And behold, Boaz came from Bethlehem and said unto the reapers, the Lord be with you. And they answered him, the Lord bless thee. Then said Boaz unto his servant that was set over the reapers, whose damsel is this? And the servant that was set over the reapers answered and said, it is the Moabitish damsel that came back with Naomi out of the country of Moab. And she said, I pray you, let me glean and gather after the reapers among the sheaves. So she came and hath continued even from the morning until now, that she tarried a little in the house. Then said Boaz unto Ruth, hearest thou not, my daughter? Go not to glean in another field. Neither go from hence, but abide here fast by my maidens. So Ruth came into Boaz's field. Boaz came by to check on the harvest, just as any owner would. You know, if you own a field, even today, and you have someone working for you, you've got to be sure that that owner's going to come by and check on how's the harvest going. You know, are we getting it in? How much have we gotten so far? Is it all good? Did any of it go bad? They're going to come by. And Boaz came by. And he looks around and he sees someone he doesn't recognize. This is a stranger. And he asks them, who is this person? Who's that lady over there in the field? I don't know her. And they tell him, that's Ruth. You know, this is the lady from Moab that came back with Naomi. And something stuck in Boaz's mind, or in his heart, whichever one you want to look at it. Something stuck there. And Boaz goes over to her and says, you know what? Stay here. Don't leave. You stay in my fields, and you glean all you need. Don't go anywhere else. And you know, if you look at this from another perspective, you put Boaz as an example of God and Ruth as an example of us. It's just what God tells us. God tells us, you know what? Stay here. Stay with me. Stay in my field. Don't leave. He tells us that all the time. Don't leave. Cling to me. Don't go any farther. Pick up what you need when you need it. Just stay with me. And he gives us that example right there. Boaz told Ruth, don't leave. And it said on verse 9, let thine eyes be on the field that they do reap, and go thou after them. Have I not charged the young men that they shall not touch thee? And when thou get a thirst, go into the vessels and drink of that which the young men have drawn. Then she fell on her face and bowed herself to the ground and said unto him, why have I found grace in thy eyes, that thou shouldest take knowledge of me, seeing I am a stranger? Boaz told her, said, you get what you need. You get thirsty, you go to my well. You stay here. You do what you need to do. And she felt so humbled. And she fell on her face in humility. I said, why are you being so good to me? Why have I found favor in your eyes? I'm no one to you. I'm a stranger in this land. I'm not even of the tribes of Judah. I'm a stranger. I'm from Moab. Why? That's the same way we do. God lays blessings in our laps. He says, stay here. I'll treat you well. And he starts telling us, you can have this, you can have that. And we fall on our face and say, God, why are you so good to me? Why are you treating me so well? Just like Ruth did to Boaz. And Boaz answered and said unto her, it hath fully been showed to me all that thou hast done unto thy mother-in-law since the death of thine husband, and how thou hast left thy father and thy mother, and the land of thy nativity, and art come unto a people which thou knowest not heretofore. The Lord recompense thy work, and a full reward be given thee of the Lord God of Israel, under whose wings thou art come to trust. She vowed to God to serve God. She left her land. She left her family. She followed Naomi in. And Boaz knew it. Boaz said, I've heard of what you've done. I've heard you've left. I've heard that you have taken care of your mother-in-law. You came with her. You have been a good daughter-in-law. You were a good wife. God's going to reward you. God is going to reward you. And that's what God will do to us. God will reward us. We hang on to him. And we are a good worker for the Lord. We do what we know to be right. What God teaches us in this book to do right. And God is going to reward us. He will not leave us forsaken. Ruth was not forsaken at this point in time. They felt like they were when they first came back. They came into a strange land. And I know many of us take walks into a strange land through our Christian life. It can be right here in this city. And we can take a walk into a strange land, an unknown land, and be strangers there. And God will give us favor.
Amen.
God will give us that favor and show us the way it is we need to go.
Amen.
And someone will come to us and reward us. Because we took that step, and we hung on to God, and we did, and went the path he sent us, just like Ruth did. Then she said, let me find favor in thy sight, my Lord, for that thou hast comforted me, and for that thou hast spoken friendly unto thine handmaid, though I be not like unto one of thine handmaids. And Boaz said unto her, at mealtime come thou hither, and eat of the bread, and dip thy morsel in the vinegar. And she sat beside the reapers, and he reached her parched corn, and she did eat, and was sufficed, and left. Not only did Ruth, was Ruth allowed to glean the field, to pick up the leftovers, he also brought her into his house, basically, and fed her with his servants. This was a stranger. He'd never met her before. But God had given her favor. God had put favor in her because she had walked away from what she knew. And she had come to the land and made that vow. And he took her in. God will do the same for us.
Amen.
God will do the same for us. And when she was risen up to glean, Boaz commanded his young men, saying, "Let her glean even among the sheaves, and reproach her not. Let her come in right where you're at. Let her come in among those sheaves, and do not tell her she can't. Do not command her that she cannot. Leave her alone. She is one of ours." It's basically what he was saying to them. She's one of ours. Leave her alone. God does the same to us. He says, "Leave my child alone. Don't touch my child. And let fall also some of the handfuls of purpose for her, and leave them, that she may glean them, and rebuke her not." Not only can she come in among the sheaves where most people cannot glean, but I'm telling you right now, drop a little bit extra for her. Let her have a little extra. And don't yell at her. Leave her alone. Let her get it. God does that with us every day.
Yes, he does.
Drop a little bit extra over here for this child of mine. Drop a little bit extra over here for this child of mine.
Yes.
And I was thinking about yesterday, Friday and yesterday. We spent Friday night and yesterday with Lisa and Sean and the kids, so I'm going to try to tell it out, okay? And I was thinking about this. Friday night, we get a call around 8:30, wasn't it? We've got a water leak. I need somebody to come and shut the water off. She calls Tony. We've got a water handle, you know, meter shut off. And we go in, we shut the water off. And Tony, we take shovels with us right away because we've had our water line break twice since we've been in our house. We know what it's like. And so we take shovels in. Tony and Draven start digging the ground and trying to find where the water's leaking out. And it's like, okay, we got to almost 10 o'clock, and it's like, okay, well, we found the general vicinity, and we're like, we'll be back in the morning. Tony's calling and this and that, and we finally got his cousin out of Kubota. Said, okay, I can, it'll take about 2.5-3 hours. Yeah, if you bring the trailer out, load it up, we'll come in, I'll come in and dig it. Problem with that was, we just got our truck Wednesday, you know, our Chevy Silverado caught fire last Saturday, burned. Engine completely lost, completely melted. No distributor, no brakes. Battery is just a hunk of something. Hunk of something. So, you know, we have this truck that we pull our gooseneck trailer. It burns Saturday. This is after having the trailer in here for our gospel sing on Friday. Take it home Saturday, it burns in front of the house. God gave us favor. We were at home.
That's right.
We were at home. We weren't on the side of the road. We weren't in the middle of Martinsville. We didn't have to pay tow bills. We just pulled it into the yard. We were good. Tuesday, Tony finds this truck online. Looks at it Tuesday night. Goes back Wednesday night. We buy this truck. Big Chevy 4x4, dually, one ton, crew cab, huge truck. Problem with it is there is no gooseneck hitch in this truck. We now have to take the gooseneck hitch out of the Silverado and put it in the big truck. Tony starts working on that on Thursday. He takes the gooseneck hitch out of the Silverado. And on Friday, he starts getting everything in place, getting the holes drilled, getting everything done. And I come home Friday night, and we tried to get it in there, and he had dog ears on the bracket and had to cut them off with torch. Well, then the metal got too hot. We couldn't mess with it anymore. So we decided, we're done for the night. Go home, go get something to eat. And then Lisa calls. And here we are. We got a truck. We've got a trailer. the first thing we do is like, well, we're going to have to get up early Saturday morning, and we're going to have to get that hitch in that truck. So we got up early. We were out there by 8:45. We were out back beating and banging and you name it, all over the place, working and shoving. And Tony would, I would jack up the side of the trailer and lift the bed up so he could get the bracket bit up in there. And then he's in there cutting more holes because we didn't have them right. Took us an hour and a half to get that hitch into that truck. But you know what? God give us favor. God give us favor. God allowed us to get that hitch in the truck. What normally probably would have been a week endeavor took us an hour and a half.
Praise the Lord.
We got it done. We got the trailer hooked up to the truck. We got out to Joey's. Got the Kubota on. Brought it into town. We got it there. We got everything together because God give us favor.
That's right. Yes.
On top of that, Joey came out, Tony's cousin, and he dug it. He dug the trench for us from the house all the way out to the pit. Had to call the mayor, because we had to break up the sidewalk.
Yeah.
And all the stuff, but he dug that ditch. About 2.5 hours is what it took him. And he followed us in, so he left.
I tried to pay.
That's the part.
He would not make it.
Lisa tried to give him payment for his time and for the money he spent for diesel.
He wouldn't
Joey wouldn't take it. Lisa found favor. Lisa found favor with God.
And this makes me think, I told George Ed this on Friday, when God finds favor with you, like Brother Pat always says, he'll cause people to lay things at your feet.
That's right.
Every time.
And you know what? And that's what's happened. Lisa's been faithful. Sean's been faithful. He's been studying. She was talking yesterday, they were studying. They have clung to God throughout all this. And when this happened, and the devil, and all it is the devil is trying to come up against them, trying to throw it at him. Because Sean, is fairly new into believing and holding true to God. And the devil's going to try to hit them, especially him, with everything he's got. Because the devil doesn't want anyone to hold fast to God. So yesterday, when she went to pay them, and you got to remember, we've heard the stories come from Lisa, what they're going through. They're living on 60% of his income. They're having difficulty meeting their bills and stuff now the way it is. And you put an expense like a broken water line into that mix, that can devastate you. That can completely devastate you. I know we've done it twice, and it's cost us anywhere from about $300 to $400 each time. Just to do it ourselves. That is not to pay someone else to do it. That's for us to rent the machine and do it all ourselves. Lisa and Sean yesterday, I think after it was all said and done, when I was thinking about the receipts we had handed back, they spent about $50. $50 to $60. $50 to $60. Endeavor to do it yourself.
God's good.
Probably a grand if you hired some company to do it. $50 to $60. Because
I wouldn't even have had money, but Sean's cousin has started this charity fund type thing on Facebook. And she had just brought that money over a couple days before and gave us cash. Or I wouldn't even have had the money to pay for that because Sean didn't get paid this week. His check didn't come because of the holidays, and I don't get paid there every 2 weeks, so I didn't have anything extra. So I had money in a can that I was able to go to and take. Well, thank God that money's there.
And see, God had given her favor. God had given that family favor. In the time of all the trouble that she's been in, just like Ruth and Naomi, they came up against the wall. They made a decision to do this one thing and to follow through. Ruth made the decision to follow Naomi and to follow her God. And she found favor with Boaz. Lisa has found favor with God.
Amen.
God put in place and in motion things throughout prior weeks that all came together at once. We had the materials because when Marie's water broke, Tony had ordered 150 150-foot of water line, and they give him a 500-roll of water line. He didn't know it until he got it. So he had 500 feet of water line, used, you know, small amount of it. We still got water line. So we had the water line already. We had to go buy the connections. That's all we had to do. And it was fixed. God give favor. Our truck burned a week ago. The only truck we had to pull our trailer. We found favor with God. He gave us a better truck. And he also gave us the ability to get it hooked up and ready to go when Lisa needed it.
He'll make a way.
God is always there. He orders your footsteps, but you have to cling close to him. You can't be wishy-washy. You can't be in and out. You have to make that commitment, that vow, just like Ruth did, and stay there. And not be like Orpah and walk away. God will bless you tremendously every time.
Amen.
And that's what I was talking about, those extra. God drops those extra bits for us. Because God dropped an extra bit for Lisa over here. Did the fundraiser online, and here's the money she needs to pay for what's going to happen. God dropped an extra bit over here, our truck burned. Doesn't look like that's a good thing. But God dropped an extra over here because we needed a better truck. He knew we needed a better truck. And we got Fall Foliage Festival Parade. We need a truck. And God blessed us 3 days. 4 days. Sunday, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday. 4 days is all it took from the time our truck burned till the time we got one. Now you don't think that's of God. Really? You go try to buy a vehicle these days. 4 days is pretty quick. And it says, and she took it up in verse 18 and went into the city, and her mother-in-law saw that she gleaned, and she brought forth and gave to her that she had served after that she had reserved after she was sufficed. And her mother-in-law said unto her, where hast thou gleaned today? And where broughtest thou? Blessed be he that did take knowledge of thee. And she showed her mother-in-law with whom she had wrought, and said, the man's name with whom I wrought today is Boaz. And Naomi said unto her daughter-in-law, blessed be he of the Lord, who hath not left off his kindness to the living and to the dead. And Naomi said unto her, the man is near kin unto us, one of our next kinsmen. And Ruth the Moabitess said, he said unto me also, thou shalt keep fast by my young men until they have ended all my harvest. And Naomi said unto Ruth her daughter-in-law, it is good, my daughter, that thou go out with his maidens, that they meet thee not in any other field. So she kept fast by the maidens of Boaz to glean unto the end of barley harvest and of wheat harvest, and dwelt with her mother-in-law. So not only did she glean during the barley harvest, she gleaned during the wheat harvest. She was blessed. She stayed there where Boaz instructed her, just like we should stay where God tells us to go. Whether that's here in this church, whether that's in a missionary field, missions do, whether that is in an outreach program into the community, we should be staying in our spot and not wander to the right or to the left. Don't wander back and forth. Stay on the path that God takes you. And if you read on, and I apparently did not get through as much of Ruth as I wanted to today. Yeah, maybe do that. But if you read on, Ruth finds more favor. She finds more favor. And you get into chapter 3 and chapter 4, and she finds so much favor in Boaz that he is willing to take her as his wife. And he even goes before the elders of the gate and says, you know, there is one person closer in kinsmanship than me. One person. And if, you know, I'll go before him. And if he wants to take you as his wife and fulfill the duties, then fine, let him do it. If not, I will fulfill the duties. God give her favor in his eyes. Because in kinsmanship, you can take on a husbandless lady, you know, relative of your family's kin, and you bear a child with them to carry on the name. So that name does not cease within the tribe. And so that's what this was about. Naomi was husbandless. Both of her sons had died, and neither one of them had created an heir to carry on the name. So at this time, Ruth comes unto Boaz, and Boaz says, I will take you as my wife. He first goes to the elders, and he goes to the next kin, and the kin says, oh yeah, I'll buy up that inheritance. And Boaz goes, there's one catch. You got to take Ruth with it. You got to bear a child to carry on the inheritance of Elimelech. And for whatever reason, he said, no, I won't do it. I can't do it at this time. And Boaz says, I will. And he carried on and took her as his wife. And at the end of chapter 4, Naomi, or Ruth, was blessed with a child. And that child that was born, name was Obed. And at the end of chapter 4, it says, and the women said unto Naomi, verse 14, blessed be the Lord which hath not left thee this day without a kinsman, that his name may be famous in Israel. And he shall be unto thee a restorer of thy life, and a nourisher of thine old age, for thy daughter-in-law which loveth thee, which is better to thee than seven sons, hath borne him. And Naomi took the child and laid it on her bosom, and became nurse unto it. And the women, her neighbors, gave it to him, saying, thy son, there is a son born to Naomi, and they call him Obed. He is the father of Jesse and the father of David. Amen. He's the one who carried on the lineage. Because Ruth had forsaken all she knew. And she made that conscious decision to follow after Naomi. And to cling to her, and to make her God her own. She was the mother of a child who then became the lineage of Jesus Christ. She obeyed God. She did what she needed to do. She was a stranger in the land, and she became the mother of a child who's the direct lineage of Christ. Think about that. God tells us to follow a path. You don't know what's going to happen years down the road, generations down the road. You need to set yourself in line with what God tells you today, because he puts you in a place for a purpose. Ruth's place was to be with Naomi, to then marry Boaz, to bear a child who then would become the lineage of Jesus Christ. She didn't know that back here 14 generations before.
Nope.
She had no idea. We don't know what's going to happen 10 generations down.
Nope.
But we need to do today what God tells us to do.
Amen. Every day with Jesus.
Thank you. birthday this morning?
George Ann Eggers.
She went Heidi. Sister Judy. Bill.
Brother Bill. Carol, they still have their CDs.
Yeah, they're not.
No, it was her birthday too. That's, I think
yeah,
that's why
she
didn't. That's why she didn't come. She didn't want to come up here.
Got their CD, $5.
Because Mr. Eggers.
But we got, here's their CD.
It's $5.
$5 donation goes 12, to the church.
12 songs on it.
12 beautiful songs. They're very good. So if anybody would like one, you can see Sister Daisy, me, whoever, they're up here, and we can get you one.
We went to see him at the senior citizen.
Oh, did you?
Billy and Dale Friday.
Was he singing there?
Yeah, yeah. He plays guitar too.
Yeah,
though,
yeah.
Uh-huh.
She's got one that's just you and his guitar.
Yeah, he did all the music on this one. Except
yeah, he plays guitar and stuff.
He plays harmonica.
Oh, Bud Collier was there. I knew his brother Dude, and you know Bud, don't you? He said to Brother Pat, grew up with Brother Pat and around all in mirror. They're going to be up there what, next?
Every Friday night they go up there.
Yeah, they go up there.
Is it every Friday?
We went up there. He took me out from
there. No, I mean up to Mary Miller. They're going to...
Oh, the...
Bud, Hugh, Carol, and Brown, Bud, Collier, and all of them.
They're going to go up to Mary Miller.
Yeah, that's what he said. He's going to...
Oh, okay. I didn't hear that.
Yeah. Well, he was...
You were talking, Jordan.
I'm pretty sure they said it was over in a couple of weeks. So.
That man, the Lord.
Give him the power, Lord. Give him the power.
I have it. This is
that's right.
Okay. Sister Green.
Sister Green.
Yeah.
Okay. We started at the beginning of the book. We started talking about creation in Genesis. And we're
going
to go through the whole Bible. We're
going to
everything.
Good. Good place to start.
Watch out.
Beginning.
She's on a roll.
That's all the classes, isn't it?
Yeah.
What's Sister Wendy talk about this morning?
Well,
the key thing. She was faithful to Naomi. God will bless when you're faithful.
Amen.
You got me. Yes, attendance this morning was 56.
Amen.
Man, that's what happened. Tithes offering was $257. Before I get our speaker up to sing, I was asked to have his wife come up and our speaker, have his wife come up and sing if she would.
Amen.
Sister Patty. And Rick, you come on up, Brother Rick. Do what you do, whatever you want to do.
Oh, funny, we're from Tennessee, but I went into a store this morning in Indianapolis to pay for gas, and the lady said, "Honey, where are you from?" I said, "Well, I was born and raised in Martinsville, Indiana." She said, "Well, you don't sound like it." I said, "That's because I've been in Tennessee for 31 years. So, give me that." Sing. This song's been on my heart this morning. You know, sometimes, and I don't want anybody to raise their hand, because I'll raise mine, because I'm guilty. Sometimes we look around at people and we think, well, they ought to praise the Lord. I know how they act sometimes. Or we think, well, I don't know what they're doing here. You know, you don't know what somebody's been through. You don't have a clue what their life's been like. You don't know the things they've had to go through just to the point where they are today.
Amen.
God gave me this song a while back, and it's really, it's touched my heart. You don't know my story. Worship the Lord.
Amen.
And When we worship the Lord, it's got to be sincere from deep down, because when you're worshiping the Lord, that is your way of showing Him what He means to you. Do you understand that? It took me a long time to understand that, because, you know, we were raised in church. We used to play church. We could entertain everybody in the church because we were around it so much. But it's not a habit-forming thing. It's got to be a sincere relationship. I just feel that in my soul this morning. I don't know why I'm saying that, but I just feel that in my soul.
Good to be here. She turned it off. Good to be here. Good to be in the house of the Lord with you today.
Amen.
I apologize for the way I was dressed. She told me before we left the house, you ought to get in your suit. You know, she ain't going to ask me to do nothing. We just going to get to walk in there, slip in, and sit down. You ought to get in your suit. She ain't going to ask me to do nothing. We just going to slip in the back there and enjoy the service. And as soon as we walked in, she said, "You got something?" I said, "I will. I will have something." We're coming for a suit, and we're coming for the wrong reason. But I enjoyed your lesson this morning. Yes, it was a good lesson. And I don't want to take but just a few minutes. Just give me just a few minutes. If you'll go with me to the book of Deuteronomy, the second chapter. I feel His presence in here. I don't like to go nowhere I can't feel His presence. And Deuteronomy, the second chapter, verse 1, if you have it, say amen. If you need a minute, say hang on.
Hang on.
Deuteronomy, the second chapter. If you're there, say amen.
Yeah.
If you need a minute, say hang on.
Okay, I'm there now.
See, we do the unity thing and it makes us better. Well, the Bible reads like this: "Then we turned and took our journey into the wilderness by the way of the Red Sea, as the Lord spake unto me, and we compassed Mount Seir many days. And the Lord spake unto me, saying, You have compassed this mountain
long enough.
Turn you northward." And let me just stop right there for just a second and just say, many times we go around the same thing and the same thing and the same thing, and we battle the same battles and the same arguments and the same things, and we deal with the same mess day after day after day. And the definition of insanity is doing the same thing, expecting different results. And God told the children of Israel, He said, "Look, you've seen that same tree for 40 years. You've seen that same mountain for all these many days. You've seen them same storms. It's time to do something different. Just turn around and go another way." Enjoyed that about Ruth this morning. When she asked me, I went straight to Ruth, and she started in on Ruth. I said, "Let me go somewhere else," because I immediately thought that sometimes we get blessed when we don't deserve blessing.
Yes, amen.
Come on. Come on.
I get blessed when I don't deserve blessing. But she went to Ruth, and I thought, well, let me go somewhere else. And as soon as I went to the second chapter of Deuteronomy, I thought, you know, God tells us often to quit going the same way. I used to have a Sunday school teacher. She's gone on now to meet the Lord, but she told us a story that Sister Mabel. She told us a story that was told to be true. And I wouldn't doubt her for nothing. She said that her husband said that they used to walk to church, and the path that they used to take had mud puddles everywhere. And in Tennessee, you know, it could rain on this side of the church and not rain on this side. And so if you want to, it just depends on where you're sitting. If you want to be blessed, you got to get up and move sometimes, you know.
Yes, amen.
And she said the path that they used to take had mud puddles everywhere, and said that when they would go walk into church, said every Sunday morning he would step in mud puddles in his dress shoes, and he would argue and fuss and just get in a foul mood. By the time they got to church, he was in a bad mood, the pastor, sometimes that happens to us, you know, sometimes we get in bad moods too. And said he would just argue about it and fuss about it, and he would just get on to her because she would kind of take the scenic route and bypass the mud puddles and go around. And he'd just walk right through just because it's a little shorter. And she told him one day, she said, "Well, if you would just want a different result,
maybe you need to take a different route. And I don't know why I'm saying this to the church this morning, but I'm just trying to tell you that if you wake up the same way, and you brush your teeth the same way, and you start your day the same way, and we get the same results at the end of the day, then maybe somewhere during the course of the day we need to change something up.
Amen.
Psalms 37, chapter verse 5 says, commit thy ways unto the Lord, trust also in him, and he shall bring it to pass. And I've learned that, Lisa, honey, we're praying for you, because when this happened to your family, we stopped in our tracks and remembered back in 88 it happened to our family as well. There was a day that they had diagnosed me to die in 88, but because we found favor with God.
Come on, somebody.
Because we might not have deserved it, but in other people's eyes, but because we deserved it in God's eyes. Get me running and started now. I'm trying to behave myself just a few minutes, but because we deserved it in God's eyes, not in other people's eyes, we found favor in God's eyes. And for a dead man all these years later, it ain't so bad. So if you just trust the Lord and not people, God got a plan for you, and he's got a way out. We just can't keep going in the same path. We just can't keep grumbling over the same thing. Oh Lord Jesus, we can't just keep arguing over the same thing. We can't just keep getting tore up over the same thing. We just can't keep getting mad over the same thing. We just can't keep getting all frustrated over the same thing. Somewhere along the line, y'all, we just need to throw our hands up and say, God, I've dealt with this, and I've dealt with this, and I've dealt with this, and I cannot do this no more. I'm just going to turn it over to you, and I'm going to turn northward this time, and I'm going to walk this way instead of walk this way. I'm going to sing this song instead of cry. Oh, Lord Jesus, I feel something up in here today. Suit or no suit, I'm here to tell you that if you want a different result, just hold your hands up in a different way. Sing a different song. Stand to your feet when you should be crying. Give God praise when there ain't no reason to praise him. Lift him up when you have no reason to say, God, I love you anyhow. It just don't matter. You have to pass this mountain long enough. Turn northward and go another way. Told Peter, he said, Satan has desired to have you and to sift you as wheat.
Yes. Be of good cheer.
And if he'd have left it right there, if Jesus would have said, hey, I hate it for you, my brother. Homie. And turned and walked away from me. Can you imagine how Peter would have, I know how I'd have been looking. Wait, is that all of it? I mean, you're going to bring a brother that message and you're just going to walk away from me? But Jesus said, Satan has desired to have you and to sift you as wheat. But he said, but don't worry about it. I pray for you. He said, be of good cheer, and I pray for you. So in other words, what he was trying to tell Peter was, listen, here in the next few days, in the next few weeks, things is going to get rough.
Yes. Come on.
Oh, God. Satan is on the rampage, and he knows that you're doing a good thing, and he knows that you love me, and he knows that he is going to try everything he can to discourage you and keep your head down. But don't you worry, don't pass this mountain any longer. Don't keep going around the same way. Don't wake up and listen to the same report over and over and over again. Somewhere along the line, y'all, we just got to stand up and hold our hand up to the Lord and say, God, I've heard what they got to say, but the Bible says that the elders obtained a good report. So I'm talking to somebody up in here today, and I'm telling you, you passed it long enough, you've been around it long enough, you have dealt with it long, this man has hurt you long enough, it has troubled you long enough, it has messed with you long enough, turn you northward and go another direction and tell the enemy, I'm not going this way no more, I'm going on the sit down and give this to somebody. I don't know who I'm going to turn this back over to, but I just need to tell the church today, listen, we love your pastor.
That's right.
Yes. We love your pastor. Yes. Our heart is going out for your pastor.
Yes.
This is where he needs you.
Yes.
This is where he needs his church to be a strong force.
Yes. Yes.
He don't need sympathy. He don't need pity. He needs prayer.
Amen.
We got a God that can do all things. We got a God. I am proud of this church to be able to walk into this church in the absence of your pastor and still feel the presence of the Lord and still hear teaching like I heard this morning. It says everything that needs to be said about this congregation. Church, lift up your head, stand to your feet, spread out your shoulders, get your chest spread out, and saints of God up in here that have been going through it, that have been battling it, that have been dealing with it, that the enemy has been messing with you, and your finances have been turned upside down, and your world has been interrupted, this is where you just stand up and say, I know what I know, 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 and I got a God that can do all things, and I will not go this way anymore. I'll turn myself around and I'll go a different direction, because I know this, my God, your God, our God can bless me over here. He can bless me right here. He can bless me right here. It's all about finding the steps that God wants me to walk in so that I can be I can serve the God that Ruth served and say, I'm going to leave the old people. I'm going to leave the old things. I'm going to leave the old habits. I'm going to quit saying the old things. I'm going to quit serving the old things. I'm going to quit saluting the old things. And I'm going to give God praise. Whether I'm on the mountain or whether I'm in the valley, I'm going to give God praise at all times. And I will not pass this way no more. Let's give God some love in here today.
So I'm not used to